Okay, it's about time. So welcome everybody to the first colloquium this semester. I'm glad we got this worked out. The speaker today is known to most of you, but in case there are some who don't know Bruce well, Professor Bruce Law came to the physics department pretty much 30 years ago and is a well-known and award-winning condensed matter experimentalist. He studies within condensed matter structural transitions in liquids, in liquid surfaces and in thin films, and uses various techniques for that, X-ray spectroscopy, neutron scattering, and optical interferometry and ellipsometry. So he's well known for that and has made many contributions over the years in that field. And that's an important field. It's of broader interests to the development of medical labs on a chip, for instance. So microfluidics, that's a hot field. It's of interest in catalysis, and it's of interest for understanding better biological processes such as osmosis. So we appreciate having such a broad thinker as a colleague. But that's not all. Bruce is also interested in cosmology, a rich discipline by itself that borders on observational astronomy and involves basically the whole spectrum of modern physics in one way or another. Quantum mechanics, statistical mechanics, you name it, it all enters cosmology. So today, Bruce is going to give a talk on his other love, cosmology. And in particular, he will talk about dark energy, a very interested topic we don't know too much about. If the fundamental laws of physics that we learn, teach, and believe in are correct at the big scale, at the galactic scale, then there is strong observational evidence that we actually don't understand how to account for most of the matter and most of the energy in our universe. So Bruce will tell us how to understand the unaccounted energy, dark energy, within a model he developed. Bruce, go ahead.
Thank you, Uwe. Actually, I came to cosmology by mistake. I didn't do it on purpose. I sort of fell into it. So this is a story about how I accidentally became a cosmologist. Let me share my screen. And okay, I was looking at my talk. Here's my talk. I got to go back to the beginning of my talk, which is another reason why I was late, was because I was looking at various things. So hopefully everyone can see my screen. And okay, let's go back to the beginning. So actually, as Uwe mentioned, I'm a soft matter physicist, experimentalist. I do theory on the side. What some people don't realize is I'm a failed theoretical physicist. I started out doing theory as in condensed matter physics, basically for 6 months. And then I thought I was doing too much algebra. And actually, the theorist I was working with, this is in New Zealand, he's very, very good, but he's more mathematical than the type of theory I do. The type of theory I do is more at the level of like engineering physics. That's the type of theory I do, and that's the level that this talk will be about. And of course, the paper that I just published recently, actually in April, given down here in this link, Astrophysics Space Science. So that's my first ever cosmology paper. So this is a story about how I got into cosmology. And as I say, I didn't mean to do it. Here's something, a food for thought. Okay, we all, here's a young lady. She's lifting this drum up. We all know that if the drum's sitting on the ground, it has less energy than when she raises it. When she raises it, it has more energy. She's given it some extra gravitational potential energy. So let us think about analogous situation, but for an electron and a positron. So here we have an electron and a positron, and we know, okay, you know, the positron is an anti-electron. So it's positively charged, the electron's positively charged, negatively charged. They come along, they annihilate each other. The energy of each photon is MEC squared. ME, of course, is the mass of the electron. We're all told about this. What we're not told, and of course we're told this, you know, in engineering physics at that level, what we're not told is we don't really think very hard about this situation, because actually the electron and the positron, they have a Coulomb interaction, and the Coulomb interaction goes as 1 upon r squared. And if r goes to 0, oh, that force is infinite. Oh, if you think about the energy between the electron and the positron, right, that's Q, the charge electron times the potential, so that energy goes as 1 upon r. So that energy also goes to infinity as r goes to 0. And we also don't really think about the electric field which surrounds the electron and the positron. What happens to the electric field when it annihilates, right? And of course, you know, so there's a lot of things missing from this picture. And of course, one of the, you know, some people will say, oh, but the electron and the positron, oh, they're quantum mechanical. So that's sort of this mysterious thing, and, you know, this thing just happens, and you've got to do quantum electrodynamics, and it gets very, very complicated. Well, actually, this very problem was something that Feynman was worried about, and there's a very, very good write-up about it in the Feynman Lectures of Physics, Volume 2. Okay, so I've read that in a lot, and of course, Volume 2 was on classical physics. One thing that you have to worry about this picture is, you know, it's a bit like the lady lifting the drum. If I come along and I separate the positron from the electron and I move it so I've got a free electron, I have to do work on that electron, right? So when the electron is far away from the positron, I've done work on the electron. Where's that energy? We're all told, oh, the free electron has an energy, the mass times C squared. It's the same as the energy of the ion, when the positron and the electron annihilate. That must be wrong, because that can't conserve energy, because actually we've done work in removing the positron and electron away and to infinity, right? That work has to appear somewhere. In other words, the free electron must have more energy than the energy that's about to annihilate. Okay, that's just conservation of energy. You might well say, oh, well, that energy is probably in the electric field that surrounds the free electron, right? Because this is just the, you know, and actually, you know, that would be a fair thought, except that if you look at quantum electrodynamics, the theory that, you know, Feynman, Stringer, and Tominaga got a Nobel Prize in, this is the interaction between electrons and photons. Actually, an assumption in that theory is that these energies are, this energy of the electron here, when it's about to annihilate, is exactly equal to the energy of the free electron. That's called mass renormalization, because actually, in the modern theory, quantum electrodynamics, this mass of the electron is electromagnetic mass. In other words, it includes the mass from the electric field, includes the mass from the inertial mass, includes everything. So there's something wrong there, and actually that's something that Feynman was worried about, and he describes in his Volume 2 book, and he never actually figured out. So it's sort of a story about that, and it's all classical physics, so there's no mysterious quantum effects coming in. How did I get into this? I got into this because I went and listened to this talk by Alan Guth from MIT in April of 2013 on this inflationary cosmology. And, you know, he was talking about dark energy and dark matter. You can see on the table here, there's these mysterious omega fractions. Okay, dark energy has an omega fraction, 0.74. Dark matter 0.21. and the baryons, i.e. ordinary protons and neutrons, they're only like 4% or 5% of the universe in terms of mass fraction. I was listening to this talk and I said, what do these omegas mean? I don't know what omega is. And then he came along and in this talk he said, dark energy, that is due to Einstein's cosmological constant, this lambda, and it's due to vacuum fluctuations in space. And then he said the magic word. He said the Casimir effect. And the thing is, as a postdoc at the University of Maryland, I taught myself how to calculate the Casimir effect. For real systems, because it's important if you're dealing with surfaces. And I thought, well, I'm sort of like an expert in this. I know how to calculate the real effect. And then Professor Guth came along and said, well, actually, the HEP, vacuum fluctuation estimate, for lambda, the Einstein's cosmological constant, is 10 to the power of 120 times too large. I was like, what does all this mean? I don't understand what this means. So then I came along, and of course, at the end of the talk, there was an question and answer session. So I asked Professor Guth, since I thought I knew the Casimir effect, I asked him the following question. I said, if the Casimir effect is to explain the cosmological constant, don't you have to take into account the dielectric constant underlying medium? And of course, Professor Guth, since he's an expert speaker, he gave me some answer. It was all about symmetry, and I didn't understand what he was talking about. And I think we were talking at cross purposes. He's a cosmologist. I'm a soft matter physicist. He didn't understand my question. I didn't understand his answer. And so that's how I got into this field. So let me talk about the Casimir effect then, okay? And why I thought, you had to understand the dielectric constant, and why I thought this had to explain the factor of 10 to the power of 120. So here's the Casimir effect that I have dealt with in my research work. I've published papers on it. The Casimir effect is if you have two perfect conductors, and of course we all know that in empty space you get vacuum fluctuations, i.e. you get electric fields there. If this is a perfect conductor, then the electric field on the boundary is zero. So you get a standing wave here, and that energy, and that standing wave has an energy of a half h bar omega. Well, you know, this is the standard vacuum fluctuations. And then you could put in another standing wave in. Of course, this standing wave here, it's got a smaller wavelength, right? So of course, you know, then it's going to have a higher frequency. You can keep on putting in wavelengths between these two things. But one thing that I knew about real materials is that perfect conductors aren't perfect. Once you get to ultraviolet frequencies, then the dielectric constant of the conductor goes to one. In other words, these perfect conductors, they have a dielectric constant of one. The medium between them have a dielectric constant of one. So then you can't get reflection of waves between this. So you've got to stop counting the half h bar omega once you get to ultraviolet frequencies. And so there you stop the summing up of these half h bar omegas. And so the thing which was occurring to me at the time is, you've got to take into account the dielectric constant of the real material because Maybe that's the reason for the factor of them being off by a factor of 10 to the power of 120. Of course, at that time, I wasn't actually dealing with surfaces. I was in a collaboration with Professor Chris Sorensen and various other people, and we were playing around with nanoparticles. And so I knew a very, very obscure fact, and that's how to calculate something called the Casimir self energy of a spherical ball. So you have a spherical ball, and you imagine it's a perfect conductor. It's a solid spherical ball. Just like for the surface Casimir effect, you have to put the electric field equal to zero on the boundary. And then you've got these waves going away, and you've got to count up all the waves. I knew how to do that calculation. And you can think of a particle, a nanoparticle is a spherical ball. You could think about a hydrogen atom as a spherical ball, okay? Except that once you get to ultraviolet frequencies, the dielectric constant of the spherical ball must go to one, so you've got to stop counting the contributions to the spherical ball. So that's why I was wondering, is this dark energy somehow due to this Casimir effect around the hydrogen atom? In other words, this is a quantum mechanical effect of the vacuum electric, the electric field vacuum fluctuations around the hydrogen atom in empty space. And I knew how to calculate this effect. And so that motivated my interest. Of course, one of the weird things about the Casimir self-energy is you never see anyone actually calculating it in a real system. So that was, it always puzzled me. Whereas the Casimir surface energy, people are always calculating that for surfaces. And it's like, well, why are they ignoring the Casimir self-energy in the bulk for nanoparticles and hydrogen atoms? It must be there. Maybe this is dark energy. So that got me thinking about it. And so, I listened to Professor Guth's talk in April. Come summer, May, I said, maybe I should look into this. But I'm a dummy about cosmology. I've never taken an astronomy class. I didn't know anything about high energy physics or anything like that. So I said, okay, let me educate myself. So I had to start reading some cosmology books for dummies. And every time I read, so here's one by Alan Guth. Here's another one by Lawrence Krauss. And then all these. And then there was also Google and Wikipedia. So I started reading these things. And whenever in these books I saw anything about the Casimir effect, I started to get excited. But again, they would bring up these omegas. I didn't understand the omegas, and they mentioned the Einstein's cosmological constant. I didn't understand that. So then I said, okay, I need to go to cosmology for undergraduates. So then I started reading Physics Today, and this was written by a guy called, I think it's Samuel Putnam. He won a Nobel Prize with a couple of other people for discovering dark energy in 1998. And of course, what happened is they were measuring supernova explosions as a function of the redshift. What we know is that the universe starts as a big bang, and everything is expanding away from us. And for things which are further away from us, i.e. at larger redshifts, they're moving faster and faster. So there's a redshift in the emission lines of the hydrogen atom. If you get a supernova explosion, you can use this as a standard candle, and you can work out basically what its velocity is, work out what its redshift is, and work out how far away it is, and things like that. And of course, what they had been expecting is, because gravity is always attractive, they had been expecting all the data to be occurring in the decelerating universe, because it's like you get an explosion, but everything's been attracted to the center or to everything else by gravity, so things should be slowing down. Instead, their data occurred in the accelerated part of the universe here. So that's the dark energy. That's what they got their Nobel Prize for. It's like a repulsive gravity. It's like anti-gravity. So it's very, very weird. They didn't know why things were repelling, i.e. speeding up rather than slowing down. Of course, even with this, I didn't understand what was going on there. And part of the reason is in cosmology, they put the speed of light equal to 1. They put H bar equal to 1. They put Boltzmann's constant equal to 1. And so there's all these dimensionless numbers that I didn't understand until I found this book by Jim Peebles. Of course, Jim Peebles just got a Nobel Prize last December, basically for dark energy and for all of his cosmology things that he's done for the last 50 years. And in this book in table 2.1, now here's something I understand. Okay, here's these mysterious omegas, right? The dark energy, dark matter, and diffuse plasma. Diffuse plasma means the baryons, the protons and neutrons. But then here on the far left on it, here's some mass densities. I understood these numbers. They weren't dimensionless. I could calculate. I was wondering, okay, for the dark energy, can I calculate this mass density? Okay, or I could change this into an energy density because I'm just multiplied by C squared, right? E is equal to mc squared. So you can get an energy density of space. Was this dark energy density of space, could that be explained by the Casimir effect, right? For, you know, basically hydrogen atoms. So I started doing some calculations and worrying about it. But before I tell you about my calculation, let me explain. Here's a picture of, I have to introduce some terminology. So we have the Big Bang explosion here. And to start off with, you can see this very, very sharp white line here. That's called inflation. That's where the universe expanded by 60-fold over a period of like 10 to the minus 32 seconds. Okay, they don't understand that at the moment. And then in the part just after the cosmic inflation, then during that time, there were lots of, the space was ionized. There were lots of photons. There's lots of positrons and electrons because it was very, very high temperatures, okay? And just a few neutrons and electrons and that. And then what happens is as space expands, it cools down. As it cools below a certain temperature, the electrons and positrons annihilate each other. The electrons find protons and form hydrogen atoms. And also helium is also formed in this part. This is before the cosmic microwave background is time. And so this is during its cooling down. So once it gets to a temperature of about I think it's about 3,000 Kelvin. Everything has recombined. The intergalactic space is now neutral, and so light can start, isn't scattered as much, and that's what gives rise to the cosmic microwave background, which occurs at about 400,000 years after the Big Bang. At this time, just after that, of course, there's no stars around. So that's called the Dark Ages. And then stars start forming, okay? The first stars start forming, you know, about 400 million years, right? Gravity comes along and brings matter together. They cluster, they heat up, and you get stars forming. And then galaxies start forming at about a billion years. And then here's today, okay? Today is, we are about 13.7, 13.8 billion years since the Big Bang, okay? In this region here, we're during the Dark Ages and during the formation of the first galaxies and that, the universe is decelerating. And then you can see where it's accelerating. Up here, it's accelerating recently. This is supposedly caused by this cosmological constant lambda. you know, that I didn't understand. They talk about this explosion in terms of other ways of measuring it, right? They can measure it using the redshift, okay? This is the redshift of the light emission lines or absorption lines from hydrogen, okay? Because things are moving away faster and faster, the emission lines, they get redshifted, right? That's because they're moving away from us faster and faster. It's a Doppler effect, essentially. So if you measure things in terms of the redshift, okay, the cosmic microwave background occurs at a redshift about 1100, okay? Of course, these lambdas, these are the lambda E, this is the wavelength of a particular emission line of hydrogen. The lambda observed, that's the measured emission line that the astrophysicists measure. So this redshift today would be zero. The other thing that you'll see in this talk is they also talk about a dimensionless scale factor. Okay, the scale factor is the size of the universe. So the scale factor today is one, okay? And then you calculate the scale factor by taking 1/1 + z. So at the when the cosmic microwave background was around, which was at 400,000 years after the Big Bang, the scale factor was about 10 to the minus 3. What that means is something which is a meter by a meter today is 1,000 times smaller when the cosmic microwave background was around. Okay, so things are a lot denser. So that's what the scale factor tells you about. Anyway, later on, I'll be blowing up this part where the dark energy is and showing that in more detail. Okay, so I have to talk about, give you some equations and stop doing the hand waving. But as I say, I talk in very simple terms and hopefully you'll understand what's going on. Here's Hubble's law. So Hubble's law, tells you about the expansion of the universe, okay? The A dot, that's the speed at which you're moving. Hubble's law says the further you are away, i.e. the larger A is, the greater A dot is, okay? Because everything's moving away from you. The proportionality constant, the H, that's Hubble's constant or Hubble's parameter. To describe the expansion of the universe, right? We assume there's an assumption one makes, and you assume that the universe is isotropic and homogeneous. And then, if you make that assumption, then actually Einstein's general theory of relativity, right, reduces to something called the Friedman equation. In the Friedman equation, let me go back. Okay, in the Friedman equation, there's something called kappa. This is basically whether space is flat or not, okay? So actually, space we believe is flat, so kappa is zero. So we get rid of that term. So flat space just means that we have normal Cartesian coordinates, okay? So we can just get rid of that. And there's astrophysical data proving that. And then you look at the rest of Hubble's equation. Okay, here we have the velocity squared. So this is basically a kinetic energy, okay, on the left-hand side. And here we can see G. This is the gravitational constant from, this is Newton's gravitational constant. So the right-hand side is basically comes from the gravitational potential energy, okay? The pi here, this is an energy density or a mass. One can think of this as a mass. So actually, this is just conservation of energy. What's actually happening is you're converting gravitational potential energy into kinetic energy. Okay, so that's how one explains the expansion of space. And then this pi, here I've got it written down. Here, when you can see the OM, that is ordinary matter. And then the pi DM, that's dark matter. And then you've got to scale it by how much matter you've got in space. So you've got to scale it by a volume, i.e. A cubed. And then here's your mysterious lambda, your cosmological constant. So this is how you describe the expansion of the universe by this equation. Let me now explain what any good theory should be able to explain. And that's not just my theory, but any theory. Okay. So what I did on this graph here, that's a blow up of this little area here where it says dark energy. So I've expanded it, and I've taken dark energy, I've taken some data from one of Barat's papers that he published in 2017. So it's a very, very recent paper. And it's a plot of basically the Hubble parameter divided by 1 plus z. So this is a dot, right? This is basically a velocity as a function of z. And you can see, actually, the solid lines of different theories. The symbols, that's experimental data. It's basically binned data. And you can see that if you're at z less than about 1, I mean greater than 1, i.e. z 1, 2, 3, you can see that actually the speed is slowing down, right? Because remember the left-hand side, a dot is a speed. So that the expansion is slowing down for large z greater than 1. Whereas at small z, smaller than 1, you can see it's speeding up, right? The velocity or the a dot is increasing. So there's a separate, you can easily see from this data, there's a distinction where something is accelerating, supposedly due to dark energy, from dark energy, and when something is slowing down. So what should any good theory be able to describe? First of all, at z equal to 0, right? Z equal to 0, that's today. You should be able to describe this energy density here, okay? And you, for those people who've got a photographic memory, you'll realize that this energy density is different than the one that I listed before. This one comes from the Planck collaboration. So there's various estimates for what the energy density today should be. So that's number one. You should be able to describe this energy density for intergalactic space today. The other thing you should be able to describe is the ratio of dark energy to the number of baryons, right? Today, if you understand dark energy, because you know how many baryons you have, you've got here the volume per baryon sitting down there. So there's two things that any good theory should be able to explain. A third thing that any good theory should be able to explain is, and actually this was in one of the referees' reports, W is equal to minus 1. And it's like, what the hell is W? W was something called the equation of state, and I didn't understand what W was, but that's what the cosmologists believe it is. It must be equal to minus 1. But basically, energy density and pressure actually have the same units, okay? So actually, this value of minus 1 just means it's accelerating, right? So is something which should happen if this thing is accelerating due to dark energy. The energy density is positive, the pressure must be negative, so that means everything is sort of expanding away from us faster and faster. The fourth thing that any good theory should be able to describe is a transition from the decelerated state to the accelerated state. that happens at a Z of about 0.8. Okay, so these are four things which come out of astrophysical data. So let me get into what I started out by trying to describe, and that is the energy density, which has this value, okay, and of 5 by 10 to the minus 10 joules per meter cubed. And the other thing to note from this is that, there is a volume per baryon of 4 meters cubed. In other words, you have one baryon, one hydrogen atom, per 4 meters cubed. So here was my picture that I had, that I started my calculations on. Basically, intergalactic space is a very, very dilute gas, okay, of hydrogen atoms or ionized hydrogen atoms, and therefore it's perfectly okay for me as a condensed matter physicist, because I know about gases, to come along and calculate the energy density for this very, very dilute gas. Basically, I have one hydrogen atom, and that hydrogen atom is either unionized or it's ionized in a 4 cubic meter box. In other words, if you take a box which is 1.6 meters on each side and you put one hydrogen atom in, that is the universe today. And you ionize it, or you don't ionize it. The ionization fraction is the new E. Okay, that's how many of these hydrogen atoms are ionized. 1 minus new E, that must be the number of hydrogen atoms, the fraction of hydrogen atoms. And then for the hydrogen atom, I said, we should associate that with a Casimir self-energy. That's due to the residual vacuum fluctuations due to the electric field in empty space. And actually, you can look up a book, and that's given by this value. And then you have to worry about the ionized hydrogen atoms. Well, they're going to be ionized. They're either going to be a proton or electron. So you worry about the electric field from, so this is a Born self-energy from ionized hydrogen. And you can just look up a book. You could look up Feynman lectures in physics. This is the energy associated with the electric field around a ball of radius r. In other words, if you had the radius of the ball, you could calculate this energy for the proton or for the electron. Okay. And so let's calculate from this very, very simple picture, let's calculate the energy density for the hydrogen or the ionized hydrogen. Here it is. Here's the total electric field or energy density. We come along, we take the Casimir self-energy for the hydrogen, that's a U Casimir H, and you multiply it by the fraction, either 1 minus U, of the number of hydrogen atoms which are not ionized. And then you come along and you add up the energy from the proton due to the Born energy and the energy from the electron due to the Born energy, and each of these are multiplied by nu E, which is the fraction of ionized hydrogen. That's the total energy. So you want an energy density. So you divide by the volume of the box, which is 1.6 meters cubed. Okay. And then you go and you Google. I Googled this stuff. You Google and you try and find out what the ionization fraction in interstellar intergalactic space is. And that new E comes out to be 0.4, 0.5. So you put this into this equation and you Google, what's the radius of the electron? And I found an estimate for the radius of the electron. And I put that into this equation and we get this number. Okay, the energy density that I calculate from this theory is 6 by 10 to the minus 10 joules per meter cubed. And then you go and compare it with what comes from the cosmic microwave background. It's 5 by 10 to the minus 10 joules per meter cubed. They agree within error bars. when I saw this, I got really, really excited. And actually, what happened was, this was in August of 2013. I was doing this little calculation because actually I had to go away and I had to drive to San Francisco to go and pick up some Japanese friends. I was going to drive them around. I said, well, I need to write this up. And only then did I see all this agrees. So, of course, me being a physicist, all I thought, well, nature will be interested in this result. So I sent it off to nature. And I got in a week and a half, I got an editorial rejection. And then I sent it to, while I was away in California, I sent it to Nature Physics, thinking, well, maybe it's too specialized for nature. So let me go to Nature Physics. I get another editorial rejection. So then I go and send it to Physical Review Letters, and I get another editorial rejection because, you know, I'm not very clued up on high energy physics. Everyone knows that the electron, the modern theory for the electron, the electron is a point particle. In other words, R is zero. So my theory can't be right because it disagrees with what everyone believes. Of course, me being a dumb soft matter physicist doesn't realize what I'm not supposed to do. Anyway, eventually I did get some real responses because I got some I sent to lower level journals. Let's now talk about this mass ratio. We should be able to describe this mass ratio as well because we have a theory. So what we do is we take the 0.69 and we divide it by the 0.04 and we get a mass ratio. It comes out to be about 14. Okay, my theory should say the mass ratio is the mass of the Born energy, right? So all I've done was I've taken the energy of the ionized electron and I've divided it by C squared to get a mass. And then the ordinary matter, oh, that's the mass of the proton, mass of the electron. Oh, that's 19 plus. Okay, these two agree. The weird thing is this, and this is, of course, one thing that would upset some of the referees, is if you calculate the equivalent mass, Born mass, associated with the electric field, which surrounds the electron. So we take the Born energy and we divide it by C squared, you get this huge number, 7 by 10 to the minus 26 kilograms. This is 40 times more massive than a proton. It's like 80,000 times more massive than the rest mass of the electron. So of course, this is, you know, this is hard to get your head around. And of course, it worried me a lot. This, of course, is why it took me 7 years to come along and publish this, is to try and work out what everything means. So this is, of course, a very controversial theory. So I disappeared down this rabbit hole because I didn't realize that the Bharat Ratra had to point out that the electron was a point particle in standard particle physics. And I didn't realize that. And that's why I get all these rejections, because people don't like what I'm doing. Because, of course, in quantum electrodynamics, which Feynman and Schwinger and Tominaga got their Nobel Prize for, was for, you know, electrons a point particle. Here's what happens in QED. You have a bare mass, which is some like inertial mass. Then you have some sort of quantum mechanical self-energy. So what actually happens is these straight lines, these are electrons going from one part to another. And then it will, you'll get emission and reabsorption of a photon. So that dresses this electron. And then you get more complicated things. That gives you this other energy, which goes as log of the radius of the electron. And then you've got my Born self-energy, which goes as one of over R. They do something called mass renormalization. So they replace all of course, the log and the 1 upon R, they diverge to infinity if R is zero. So they do a mass renormalization. They say, oh, this is just the energy, MEC squared. We know what that is. So they replace these infinite quantities by a finite quantity. And because of this all happened back in the 1940s and 1950s, they didn't know what the radius of the electron was. And Dirac didn't like the replacing infinities by finite numbers. Part of the problem with mass renormalization is that energy is not conserved. So if you take this previous equation, this one here, the big long thing on the left, and you retain that, and you think about positron, electron, and what they do, you can write down an equation. So here it is. Here's a total energy of a positron and electron interacting. This thing in the big curly brackets is that big long expression I have. I multiply it by 2 because that's the energy of the proton or the electron or the positron, right? And then you've got to add in a Coulomb interaction. So that's what I have here, minus Q squared over R. So this is standard engineering physics 2, right? And then you look at various limits. If I look at the annihilation of the electron and the positron, I take the little r and I put that, make that go to Re. Okay, so actually the electric field contributions disappear. Oh, that's nice. I don't have to worry about the electric field contributions during the annihilation. They just disappear because you've got 2 times this thing here. And so the things with the Q squareds, they disappear. And then then this is standard QED mass renormalization. This is what they normally do, is they replace the bare energy and this log R term, and they put an MEC squared, except that normally what they do is they throw out the Born energy. Then I can come along and look at the other limit of R goes to infinity. Okay, when R goes to infinity, I drop the term on the far right. Okay, I drop the term on the far right, which is the Coulomb interaction. And we get this term here. So actually this Born energy is just the work that I've done against the Coulomb interaction. Okay, so everything makes sense classically, okay? So now we have retained energy conservation in classical physics. Right, there's this equation of state you can prove, and I won't prove it here, it's proved in my publication. Basically what you have is you have a charge here, minus Q. If you get it to reflect off a perfectly conducting wall, oh, there's an image charge at distance X plus Q away, you can prove that this equation of state holds. So I won't go through the details. It's just some simple algebra. So the last thing that you'd like to do in any theory is you'd like to explain the fact that the deceleration, acceleration happens at about a Z of about 0.8, okay? So here is the Friedman equations, okay? The standard model for cosmology is where this pi has a ordinary matter component, dark energy matter, and a cosmological constant, lambda. And I get rid of that cosmological constant, and I say, oh, it's really due to the Born energy, due to ionized electrons, okay? So what you do is you can rearrange the Friedman equation and this equation and work out what the new E is, what the ionization of the universe should be as a function of Z. You just take these things, these two equations, and you rearrange them. You do a little bit of algebra and you separate out new E, okay? And what you can do is you can take the data from Barat's data that he published for the for Hubble's constant, and you know what H is at various Zs, you can put that in here, you can calculate this. And then these pi ordinary matter and pi dark matter, you can put those in and subtract them. And this gives you the ionization as a function of Z. And you want to say, oh, does this look reasonable or not? Okay, because that's an interesting thing. And then what causes the ionization of intergalactic space? That's another thing you've got to try and understand. So that's what I did here. Here's a new E calculated from Barat's data, plotted as a function of Z. Okay, it goes down to zero at a Z of about 2.5. Here's some computer simulation data, which is another, people have done some simulations. The new E that I use for my calculation at Z equal to zero, that's about 0.4, 0.5. Okay, so that agrees with this little thing that I've just inverted. Why does intergalactic space become ionized? Okay, so what happens in intergalactic space is there's something called the warm-hot intergalactic medium. What happens is you have voids where there's a low density of hydrogen in the voids, and you have a cosmic filamentary structure where the density is a little higher, and actually where these filaments meet, so at the bright, bright points there, that's where you've got galaxies and things, okay, at the intersections. But on these filamentary structures, you've got hydrogen flowing from the voids into the cosmic filamentary structure. And the cosmic filamentary structure is at high density. It's not that high density. It's like 5 to 200 times more dense. And actually, what you have is you have hydrogens colliding with hydrogens, and you get ionization of the hydrogen at temperatures of 10 to the 5 to 10 to the 7 Kelvin. Okay, so this comes out from from astrological measurements. This cosmic filamentary structure at Z equal to 4 or 5 is not present. And you get, as a function of time, or as a function of smaller Z, the gas flows in, you get ionization in the filamentary structures, and that's why the new E is increasing. Okay, I haven't yet explained the crossover between acceleration and deceleration. What you actually have to do is you have to convert the Z to time. So that's what I've done in the next one here. Okay, this is the same new E data, but on a log-log plot, and I've converted the Z to actual time, and then you have to do a little bit of math. Here's a little math you do, okay? The left-hand side, this came from my Friedman equation. The left-hand side, of course, is H. And then, as I say, the principal effect is caused by the ionization of electrons. So I've got nu E, which will be a function of time, divided by A cubed. And then you can just, this is a differential equation. So you can go and just solve this thing. It's a first order differential equation. You solve it and you find, oh, A just varies like this as a function of time, where S is this parameter, which tells you, oh, how the ionization changes as a function of time. And what you want is you want the thing to be accelerating. For an accelerating universe, what you do is you look at A double dot, right? Rather than A single dot, you just differentiate this equation for A twice, and that tells you, oh, the thing is accelerating if S is greater than 1. So on the plot above here, right, on my graph, I put a slope of 1, right? In other words, things start accelerating when you have a slope greater than 1. And so for Z less than 0.79, things are accelerating from my theory. And this basically agrees with what Bharat calculated for the deceleration-acceleration transition. Okay, one other thing. You know, my theory also suggests a dark matter candidate. right? The dark energy, I say, oh, that comes from hot electrons at temperatures in intergalactic space of 10 to the 5 to 10 to the 7 Kelvin. Oh, dark matter. Oh, a natural candidate for that would be cold electrons, which are actually created. There's a reionization of the universe, which occurs from quasars at Zs of about 6 or 15. So you could come along and you could use the same theory, right? The ratio of dark matter to baryons. You could say, okay, let me calculate the dark matter fraction. And you just use this equation. And here's a dark matter fraction.
So Bruce, we keep this Zoom session going. Just a hint, it's 5:27.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, I've almost finished. My apologies. I lose track of time. So, right. The theory says, oh, here's dark matter. Here's dark energy if S is greater than 1. And here's my summary. Okay. My theory basically says that dark energy comes from hot electrons. And my theory can explain these 4 points. It also explains energy is conserved, and also has basically a suggestion for what dark matter is. Okay, thank you very much. I will stop here. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Bruce. That was very interesting, and is perhaps also a message for especially the young people in the audience, what the attendance of just one colloquium in 7 years ago can trigger. I understood this was motivated by you attending the 1913 colloquium on cosmology. For questions, I suggest you use the chat box and either write your question in the chat box, and I will repeat it to everybody, or you just write in it, I have a question, and I will monitor the chat box. So are there comments on Bruce's talk? So you find the chat box at the command bar at the bottom of your Zoom screen. So maybe while people
are thinking about it.
Well, I had one. I mean, your theory or model builds on QED. So you have basically the polarization field around a charge as important input, and then use the renormalization technique for that. So you don't question what was done there.
I think in QED, when I think about it, it's not explained very well in my paper. I think what QED did, their quantum mechanical effects, their renormalization is fine, but they come along and they ignore the Born energy. They assume it's zero. I've just put it back in, okay? So I think my theory is consistent with QED, which is good because that's the most accurate theory in physics, right?
Right. And that's what I wasn't clear about, because if they leave something out, QED, the lamp shift of hydrogen, for instance, is one of the most precisely measured quantity reproduced to many digits by QED. Then that's strong evidence that theory works.
Right. Well, let me go back to. I can. If I share my screen again and go back to that particular part of the slide. Okay, let's see. Okay, here, QED right, QED basically comes along and takes the bare mass and this A log R and says, oh, that's basically MEC squared. the born self energy, they just assume, they just ignore it. They say it's a classical term. So they don't tell you what they do with it. I think they just assume it's not there. And what I've done is I've put it back in. You put it back in, and then that leads to the dark energy effect, essentially. So I don't think my theory does anything to upset QED.
All right.
Okay. I think it's still okay.
Okay.
But I claim that the radius electron is now non-zero. It's finite, but that's fine. If you come along, it won't upset anything.
Okay. Thank you. In the meantime, okay. There are many questions actually. So the first one is from Kevin Carnes. What do cosmologists think of your theory?
Oh, I don't know. I will find out that next spring, because I'm planning on giving some talks at some conferences. There'll be Zoom talks, of course. So I've had input from Bharat. Bharat has been useful. He told me that the electron was, assumed to be zero, point particle, point mass, and I didn't realize that. He pointed out his 2017 paper, which of course is a key thing in my paper, because I actually use exactly his data. I think some cosmologists, it's very, very controversial, because it says that particle physics is a little wrong and cosmology is a little wrong. And so for someone to stick their neck out and say, oh, hey, look, I believe in Law's theory, they have to go against the grain of what is currently considered. And so for them, that could ruin their reputation. Whereas I don't have a cosmology reputation. I have a consent reputation. So it doesn't matter. I don't have one.
Okay. There's another question by Risha Jankowiak, who asks, as space expands, does the dark energy remain constant?
Okay, that's a good point. No, it doesn't. Let me go. Okay, because of course that's what they assume with the Einstein's constant in the theory, the lambda CDM theory. They assume a constant dark energy. Okay, so that's a good point. So let's go back to which equation? This equation here. What actually happens to get an effect is you need S to be greater than 1, right? If S is too small, what happens is the expansion of space basically will kill off any effects due to the ionization. So you need to have the hydrogen atoms be able to ionize fast enough in order that you get a repulsion between, because basically what you have is you have basically this massive electric field energy, right? It was 40 times larger than the mass of a proton. So that dominates. That's the electric field mass of the electron. That dominates, and that gets repelled by another born electric field mass. So that's where the repulsion comes from. But space is expanding. So if space expands too fast, you won't see this effect, okay? Because you're not making the ionized, you're not ionizing the hydrogen fast enough. So actually the fact that nu E changes with time, that means that this effect is not constant. So if we come back to this equation here, right? The Friedman equation, okay? The new E is changing with time. So in my case, the dark energy is changing with time. Okay.
Okay. The next question is from Brett De Paula, who asks, now that you have dealt with the zero radius issue, will you resubmit to Nature Physics?
Oh, I can't second publish.
Okay.
I already published it. I can't. This is the rules of science. You can't double publish.
Okay, good. Then Andrew Ivanov asks, intergalactic ionized hydrogen is low density plasma, but the equation of state for plasma is not E over P equals minus one.
Okay. We'll have to talk about that because, you know, we're covering all of physics.
Mm-hmm. Okay,
No one can understand everything. My equation of state is not for, it's a very, very dilute plasma. Remember, there's only one electron per 4 meters cubed. Mm-hmm. So I'd think of it not as a plasma, but just of a gas, right? And so if you just come along and basically this is from Jackson, right? You take a charge, you put an image charge there. So the charge, you could, in this case, you can get rid of the perfect conducting wall and you just look at the interaction between the minus charge and the plus charge, and you can get a force there. And then you can get the force per unit area acting on that wall. You can also calculate the energy density. You can, at least in this model, you can show it's equal to minus one. I don't know what happens if you've got a very, very dense plasma, right? That's a good question, but I think of this as an extremely dilute gas, the most dilute gas you can possibly get.
All right, let's take one more question by Erfan Saidansat. How good is the assumption to consider the universe as just filled with hydrogen atoms or protons?
Good point. So actually, right, that's one thing I worried about. I think, what is it? It's like, I've forgotten the exact numbers. I knew the exact numbers a while back, and now I've forgotten them. But it's like 90% of atoms are actually hydrogen atoms. I think they know this from cosmological data. Because intergalactic space is so big, right? And I think about 10% of the mass, if I remember correctly, is in galaxies, and everything else, like 90% of it, is between galaxies. So you can forget about the galaxies and things like that. So that's why I considered it as a dilute gas. Of course, there's always corrections to any theory, and you've got to basically model which takes into account most of the phenomena that you would like to explain.
All right, I think I skipped one question by Kelly Runoff. In your summary slide, you mentioned ionized electrons. What does that mean? Sorry if you explained that already.
Oh.
That's a common use of the word ionized. That's atoms are ionized, strictly speaking, not electrons.
Oh, okay, right. So hydrogen atoms, right. Okay, maybe I should do away with the, it's really ionized WIM. The WIM is ionized.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe you could do away with the word ionized there. Right.
All right. So you answered all the questions, Bruce.
Thank you very much for this very nice
colloquium. Thank you for suggesting.
Yeah, thank you for suggesting me that I give a talk. It's good practice for me, because I'll actually have to face some real cosmologists in the future, and I don't know what's going to happen then.
So we have all been guinea pigs. That's good to know.
Yes, yes, I needed practice.
Okay, all right. Thank you again.
Okay, thank you.
And goodbye, everybody.
Okay.
Thank you for attending. That was a very good turnout with up to 66 people in the audience.
Okay. Good.
Okay. Goodbye, everybody.
Okay. Bye.
Bye, Bruce.